required for you to understand the clinical topics. So from the first few, for the next few sessions, I will concentrate more on the clinical topics. I will concentrate on more on the topics which are practically important for a physiotherapist, for a doctor. So in this one, this session is something like a bridging session between anatomy and the clinical one. So once we complete this session, we will be able to localize the lesion. Localizing a clinical level of lesion is very important. So unless you understand this particular fiber tracts, you'll not be able to localize a lesion. Suppose the lesion is a 6C6. So what are the complaints? What are the clinical signs you are going to see? Suppose the lesion is involving the motor cortex, what complaints you will see? Suppose the lesion is involving the dorsal column, dorsal D1. So what are the lesions you see? So to understand all these things, you should be able to understand these basic tracts. There are so many tracts in a spinal cord that if I start teaching you all of them, it will become really messy and it will be very taxing on the brain. Believe me, there are so many tracts. At least I should be say there'll be 10 to 20 tracts which can be taught. But clinically, three tracts are very important. So we'll be dealing with those three tracts mainly. So basically, how are the tracts divided in our... Today, I don't have a pen. So everything I'll be doing with the mouse. So basically, the tracts are divided into what? We have the ascending tracts and the descending tracts, right? So what are the ascending tracts we are going to deal with? So the ascending tracts, two important tracts we are going to deal with. The first track is the spinothalamic tract. The second one which are going to deal with is the dorsal column, medial lemniscus tract. These two are the important ascending tracts. By ascending tracts, I mean these are the sensory tracts which carry the impulses from the periphery to the brain. And what are the descending tracts? 1 minute. Sorry for the interruption. If I am not audible, put it down in the chat because I will not have any feedback if I am not audible. And what are the descending tracts? There are so many descending tracts, but one track is very important. So what is the descending track which is very important? So the descending tract, which is the most important, is the pyramidal tract, which is also known as the corticospinal tract. So I'm going to speak only about these three tracts. One descending tract, that is a pyramidal tract, or the corticospinal tract, and two ascending tracts, that is the spinothalamic tract and the dorsal column. Am I audible? Just give me a feedback because I don't get a feedback when I'm on my this one. No one is asking me anything, so should I take for granted that I'm audible? So coming to the next one. This is a brief revision of what I have already told you. These things are important for you to understand the next topic. So this orange structure which I am seeing is the cortex. This is a cerebral gray matter. This entire thing, which white one you are seeing, is known as a deep white matter. And this, you can see this fan-like structure. This fan-like structure is known as the corona radiata. Third one, all these blue things and red things are the deep ganglia, that is the caudate nucleus, putamen, globus pallidus, the thalamus, all these things. These are all the basal ganglion structures. So can you see this track which is going in between the basal ganglia? This one is the area of the internal capsule. And then we have the brainstem. So two things which you need to understand, the corona radiata and the internal capsule. So the corona radiata is a fan-like structure. So corona radiata is a fan-like structure. It is situated in the deep white matter. Other thing which you have to remember is internal capsule is situated in between the basal ganglia. So am I clear until here? And what you have to remember is all these nerve tracts, when they're coming from the motor cortex, they're far from each other. But once they reach the internal capsule, they are very closely situated to each other. They form a tight bond. This is very important. This is very important, and I will be telling you later on. So the same picture in a simplified way. So this is the motor cortex. These are the corona radiata, the two fan-shaped structures. These small, highly condensed fibers, these are present in between the basal ganglia. This is the thalamus, these are the basal ganglia. So this is the internal capsule. And now it enters through the cerebral peduncles, that is in the midbrain, into the brainstem, and then into the spinal cord. Second one, which all of you should know, what I've told in the previous session, is the motor homunculus. So this is the motor homunculus. So what do you mean by motor homunculus? This is the top view of the brain. So this one is the motor cortex. This is the sensory cortex. In the motor cortex, a particular part of the motor cortex is concerned with particular part of the body on the opposite side. So as you can see, so this is the coronal cut which I have taken. So the lowermost portion, so this portion, corresponds to face. So you can actually imagine that. So how will you remember it actually? Last time I have told you, how will you remember the motor homunculus? You can actually imagine that a person is hanging here. This is his head. So you can imagine that a person is hanging with the knee over here, legs over here. So this is medial part of the cerebral cortex. This is the lateral part. So head is in the lateral part. We have the neck and body here, and the knee and the legs and the genitalia on the medial part. So you can actually imagine as if this is a wall, and I am putting my legs on one side of the wall and I am hanging, so that my legs, knee and genitalia are on the medial side of the wall. And all of the lateral surface, we have this one. So when you can see the motor homunculus, the lips and the face and the thumb have a very big representation because they are very sensitive and they have very fine movements. We have the trunk, because the trunk is not very sensitive. The muscles on the trunk are not well developed. They are not destined to do finer activities. So the representation for the trunk is very low. There's a representation for the thumb, fingers, and the face is very big. This is the same for the motor homunculus and also for the sensory homunculus. Fine. So this also is a basically revision. I wanted to revise the concept of lower motor neuron and the upper motor neuron. What did I say? So this entire one is the reflex arc, that is the sensory fiber from the receptor through the dorsal root ganglion, through the dorsal horn, reaching the spinal cord. And this is a motor nerve reaching the muscle. So this is a reflex arc. One reflex arc is controlled by one segment of the spinal cord. So this slice of the spinal cord, which I'm showing you, is one segment of spinal cord. So this segment automatically regulates the movement. So whenever there's a pain stimulus, your leg moves. This is a reflex action. This is mediated by one segment of the spinal cord. And over it, we have the brain influencing. So these are the tracks which are coming from up downwards. So those from the upper neuron, the lower motor neuron. So answer this question. So the upper motor neuron are the brain as an inhibitory influence or an excitatory influence on the lower motor neuron. Are excitatory. I want all of you to type. This question I have asked even the last time. Kindly tell me whether the brain has an inhibitory influence or an excitatory influence on the lower motor neuron. Yeah, this is very important. So brain has an inhibitory response. So if suppose I remove the UMN, suppose I remove, ablate, I remove the UMN. So what happens to the reflex arc? Does it overact or does it underact? I'm waiting for an answer. Right. So when we ablate the UMN, so reflex R becomes overactive. So this concept I want you to remember. Now coming to the pyramidal tracts. So in every tract, I will not go into so many details which will confuse you. Most important details only we'll see. Okay, most important points which you have to remember, I will be telling you. So this is the pyramidal tract. Fine. So pyramidal tract, the pyramidal tract starts from the pyramidal cortex, that is the motor cortex. So this is the cortex, which is cut and not shown here. This fan-like structure is the corona radiata. These fibers condense together in the internal capsule. Then they enter the brainstem. In the lower part of the medulla, it divides into two portions, the lateral spinothalamic tract and the anterior spinothalamic tract. The lateral spinothalamic tract decussates in the medulla and reaches the opposite side. You can just forget the anterior cortical. I don't want to touch the anterior cortical spinothalamic tract just because I want to make things everything clear. I don't want to make things complicated. So just forget the anterior cortical spinal tract. So if I say cortical spinal tract, I mean the lateral cortical spinal tract. So it arising from the motor cortex. Second one is the corona radiata. Third one is the internal capsule. Fourth one is the brainstem. It decussates or crosses to the opposite side and then enter the spinal cord. So until now, it's the upper motor neuron. In the spinal cord, it decussates in the, it synapses in the gray column. Then the lower motor neuron comes, which forms a part of the reflex arc. Sometimes there is interneuron. So first question which I want you to answer is, so how many neurons are involved in tract? How many orders of neurons are involved? I want you to answer this first question. I'm waiting for your answer. So how many orders are neurons? Descending trap, two orders. Sometimes there is an interneuron, but not very important. So when it comes to descending tracks, so we usually don't say first order neuron, second or third. You say upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron, because they're clinically important only two neurons. So one is the upper motor neuron, one is the lower motor neuron. So there are only two orders of neurons. Sometimes there is an interneuron between the both the neurons, so it makes three, but practically remember it as two. So this entire pink one, which I have shown, is the upper motor neuron from the motor cortex until the spinal cord. And the second motor is, and the from the spinal cord to the muscle is the lower motor neuron. Second one, what is the function of the pyramidal crux? So what is the function? Right. So the main function of the pyramidal tract is the motor, control of the motor movements. Third one is the most important one, which you have to remember, is where does the decussation take? This is the most important thing which you have to remember. Where does the decussation occur? I'm waiting for your answer. The third answer is very important. So where does the decussation occur in the pyramidal tracts? Does it occur in the cortex? Does it occur in the brainstem? Does it in the brainstem, where does it occur? Or does it occur in the spinal cord? Yeah, lower part of the medulla. So this is the most important which you have to remember. So it occurs in the lower part of the medulla. So let me ask me a few more questions. So let me ask me a few more questions, okay? Something has happened. Something has happened here. It's not working. So suppose there's a lesion here. So lesion here. So patient will have weakness on what side? Is the weakness seen on the right side or the left side? So this you can say is the right. Okay. So suppose I've injured the lesion here. So suppose we say this is lesion A. So suppose the lesion is at this level. So the patient has an injury on the right internal capsule. So patient will have weakness on which side? Right. So patient is going to have a weakness on the left side. Again, now in lesion B is in the upper part of the brainstem. Suppose the lesion is on the midbrain. So where will the patient have? When you are answering, say A, left side, B, which side? because there are two lesions, A and B. So when you are answering, I want to know you are speaking about which one. So in lesion B, which is in upper part of the brainstem, suppose they are saying the midbrain, so patient will have weakness on which side? So left side. Now imagine the lesion C is in the lower part of the medulla. So lesion C is in lower part of the medulla. So where will have the patient weakness? On the left side or the right side? I'm waiting for more answers. Dr. Kishan says he will have weakness on the same side. On the left side. Right, that is on the same side. Fine. Now the next question, in A, B and C. So let's keep a lesion here, D. This is in the spinal cord. Okay, A and B were lesions on the right side. C and D are lesions on the left side. So the lesion is in the spinal cord on left side. So patient, what weakness will he have? So answer D, is it left or right? Or answer D, answer same side or left, opposite side? D same side. Fine. Is there any difference in the weakness in C and D? In C also, you are finding weakness on the same side. D also, you are finding weakness on the same side. But is there any difference? In C, am I injuring the upper motor neuron or the lower motor neuron? In C, so is it the UMN or LMN? Fine. In B, is it UMN or LMN? B, is it UMN or LMN? And Dr. Ramarajan has asked even before I could ask. So in D, the lesion is LMN or UMN. So as Dr. Ramarajan has already answered, D is LMN. So I think I'm very clear. So you should be able to tell the when there is a lesion, whether the weakness will be on the same side or the opposite side. Second one which you have to answer is whether the lesion is UMN or LMN. So when the LMN, and that is the lowermost order of neurons involved, you have the LMN lesions. And LMN is usually on the same side. But UMN can be there on the same side or it can be on the opposite side also. So UMN may be same side or opposite depending on the site of the lesion, but LMN is always on the opposite side. So these are also known as the corticospinal tracts. There are some tracts which end in the brainstem. From the brainstem, we have the LMN. They enter into cranial nerve like this. So what are these tracts called? Suppose pyramidal tracts entering the brainstem from the in the cranial nerve nuclei. From the cranial nerve nuclei are all the cranial nerves. The hypoglossal nerve, the glossopharyngeal nerve, the seventh nerve, which have a motor component. So these fibers, these tracts are known as the corticobulbar tracts. The tracts which enter the spinal cord are known as the corticospinal tracts, and the tracts which end in the brainstem to start as cranial nerve nuclei are known as the corticobulbar tracts. So you needn't remember all nonsense. You'll have to remember only these three answers. How many neurons are involved in the pyramidal tract? So only two neurons, that is upper motor neuron and the lower motor neuron. What is the function of the pyramidal tracts? They control the motor functions. They are useful for the fine motor control. Where does the decussation occur? The decussation occurs in the lower part of the medulla. Second one. Let's go to the spinothalamic tract. So the spinothalamic tract is an ascending tract. So where does it start? It starts in the receptor. So we have the pain receptors, we have the pressure receptors, we have the touch receptors. From the receptors, the nerve fibers enter the dorsal column. They have a ganglion in the dorsal root ganglion. And then through the dorsal horn, they enter into the gray column. Here, the second order neuron starts. So second order neuron starts from there, crosses to the opposite side. This is very important. So decussation of the spinothalamic tract occurs in the spinal cord. Then they reach through the spinal cord, the brainstem, and they synapse in the thalamus. So we have the first order neuron. That is from the periphery until the gray horn of the spinal cord. We have the second order neuron from the gray horn of the spinal cord to the thalamus. And we have the third order neuron from the thalamus to the sensory cortex. So let us answer the same question. First one, how many order neurons are there? I will wait for your answer. How many order neurons are there in the spinothalamic tract? Second question, what is the function of the spinothalamic tract? What sensations does it carry? There is a 10 second gap between what I'm telling and what you are hearing. So these are three important things which I have to remember. So even though there's a gap in what I'm speaking, I'll wait for your answers. I want each and every one of you to answer. What is the function of the spinothalamic tract? Pain, temperature, and anything else. You are missing something else. So the function of spinothalamic tract is pain, temperature, and crude touch. Even if you have answered, answer it again. I want everyone to say all the functions of the spinothalamic tract. Pain, temperature, and what? Pain, temperature, and crude touch. And third question, again very important, the spinothalamic tract decussation occurs where? Right. The decussation of the spinothalamic tract occurs where? This is very important. You have to remember. Spinal cord, fine. And okay, yeah, I will not confuse you much. Only these three things you have to remember. So again, let's go to question. This is A, this is B, this is lesion C. Okay, so in which conditions among A, B, and C, patient will have loss of pain and temperature on the same side of the lesion? I'm repeating again, among A, B, and C, in which lesion the patient will have loss of pain and temperature and touch on the same side of lesion? Right. So everyone is right. In C, patient will have loss of sensations on the same side, whereas in A and B, the patient will have loss of sensations on the opposite side of lesion. Final track, this is a dorsal column pathway. So this is a sensory track. Again, this is going to have three order neurons. So the first order neuron from the pressure receptors in the periphery, they enter the spinal cord through the dorsal column, and they within the spinal cord, we have the tracts which are known as fasciculus cuneatus and the fasciculus gracilis. They are located in the lower part of the medulla. Okay, so the first order neuron is from the periphery to the nucleus cuneatus and gracilis, which are located in the lower part of the medulla. So this is first order neuron. Second order neuron starts from the nucleus cuneatus and gracilis and ends in the ventroposterior medial nucleus of the thalamus, VPL nucleus of the thalamus. And third one, as usual, from the thalamus, it goes to the cerebral cortex. What are the name of the receptor carry various sensations? There are many receptors. There are Merkel's, Ruffini's, Cruz's, Krause's receptors. So each receptor has a different function. Meissner's are the pressure receptors. Ruffini's are the receptors for hot. Krause are the receptors for cold. But all those are theoretical receptors. In our clinical practice, they are not very important. So I'm not going into names of the various receptors. Okay. So let us go on to what is clinically very important. So like all the sensory pathways are ascending pathways, all the ascending pathways have three order neurons. So which order neuron crosses? Always the second order neuron decussates. And so the dorsal column pathway, again, let us ask the same three questions. How many order neurons are present in the dorsal column pathway? Two or three? So there are three order neurons. Second question which I'm asking you, what is the function of the dorsal column pathways? I want you to answer all the functions of the dorsal column pathway. All the functions of the dorsal columns. So the dorsal column mediates pressure, vibration, and fine touch. You should not forget fine touch. So the touch, we have a different pathway for crude touch and a different pathway for fine touch. So the crude touch goes through everyone has answered it right. So the fine touch goes to the dorsal column pathway. And third one, which is very important one, so decussation of dorsal column pathway is where? Is it in the spinal cord or in the medulla? Right, it is there in the lower part of the medulla. So from clinical point of view, in these three pathways, we'll have to remember only these three questions. If you remember these three questions, you will understand you will be able to localize the lesion. Okay. So again, coming to UML lesion and the LMN lesion. But before I go there, one thing I want to make the concept of a spinal segment. Okay, let me draw something. I will draw one spinal segment. As I've told you, all these nerve root pairs which are coming and joining to form one spinal nerve root, it's all the nerve roots. All the roots join to form one spinal nerve. So this entire thing is the one spinal segment. So I want to I will take some time over here, and again I will explain you this concept of LMN and UMN is very important. So let us say this is a cervical cord. Okay, let us draw 7 segments in it. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, some segments I have drawn. So let me label it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So we have tracks going through it. We have the pyramidal tracks going to the segment 1. There they synapse and it forms a LMN nerve root which goes to C1 nerve muscles. Then we have a fiber which is going to second spinal segment C2, and again it forms the second LMN. This supplies the muscles which is supplied by the C2 myotome. This concept is very important, so I'm going to go slow. Have patience, and if you have a pen and paper, try to draw it on your pen and paper. How many of you have your pen and paper? So this is nerve fibers which are going to 3, and these are the nerve fibers which are going to 4. Okay. Now let us see, there is injury at C2 level. Okay, so injury is at which level? Injury is at the C2 level. Okay, so what I have drawn is the pyramidal tracks. So pyramidal track from above until C1 segment, this is LMN for the C1. Similarly, UMN for C2, LMN for C2. Now, suppose there is an injury to the C2. Now answer me, what in this hypothetical situation, there is injury to the C2 spinal cord segment, what happens to the C1 muscles? What happens to the C1 muscles? If you understand this concept, all the next sessions are going to be very easy for you. Whether you're right or wrong, just answer. Yeah, in C2 lesion, what happens to C1? Dr. Ramarajan said C1 is normal. Dr. Shivank has said only C2 is affected. Abdul Khaliq said C1 is affected, that there is weakness. So I had 3 answers and all the 3 people have given different answers. Is there anyone else? Dr. Kishan says C1 is not affected. So I have 2 people who are saying that C1 is normal. Even Dr. Shivank says C1 is normal. Anyone else going to take a chance? So you 3 people are right. C1 is normal because the lesion is below C2. You can just think like the electrical wiring. The electrical wiring to C2 is normal. The UMN fiber to C2 is normal. LMN fiber to C1 is normal. So So C1 will be normal. Now, what happens to the C2 segment? Will there be weakness? If there is weakness in C2, will it be LMN weakness or UMN weakness? So Dr. Ramarandan says C2 weakness will be there and it will be LM. So what is the take of other people? Is C2 be going to be normal or abnormal? If abnormal, is it going to be LMN or UMN? I'm waiting for all of your answers. So this is also clear. What happens to C3? First, I want to say, will there be weakness in C3 segment or not? Dr. Shivank, I want you to answer, will there be weakness in C3 or not? Dr. Ramanathan says UMN, Dr. Abdul says LMN. Is anyone going to say it's going to be normal? Dr. Abdul, your S I didn't understand. Is it UMN or LMN? So Dr. Shivang said C3 is normal. So this is what I wanted you to know. See, when I am a lesion at C3, C1 is obviously normal, but C2 element. Anil, okay, 20 minutes in for you. Okay, so when there's a lesion at C2, just like Arjuna tried to concentrate what happened to the electrical supply of C3. So I'm drawing. So this is the UMN nerve for the C3, which goes through C1, which goes through C2, which reaches C3, synapses in C3 and forms the LMN of C3. So when there's a lesion at C2, UMN nerve of UMN neuron of C3 is affected. So C3, what you'll be able to see is C3, there will be weakness. And the kind of weakness you are going to see is the UMN kind of weakness. What Dr. Kishan has explained is exactly right. C3 is not going to be normal. You will have weakness in C3, which is UMN type. Am I clear? Which is UMN type. And the weakness is going to be on the same side or opposite side? The weakness is going to be on the same side and opposite side. Right, because the decussation is above in the medulla. The decussation is somewhere over here. So this lesion is after the decussation. So lesion will be on the same side. So what clinical features can you see at C4? So what clinical features will you be seeing at C4? Everything is same. C3, C4, C5, C6, C7, D1, D2. Everyone will have weakness. The weakness will be on the ipsilateral side of the lesion, and the weakness will be UMN kind of lesion. Only a C2 segment LMN kind of lesion is seen. So now you have understood concept of UMN and LMN. So you know the function of UMN is inhibitory to LMN. So it is inhibitory, that is negative. So what are the clinical features of UMN versus LMN? So what happens to tone in UMN lesion? tone. Whenever there's a humanness increase, the negative force is lost. So the reflex heart becomes hyperactive. So the tone increases. Second one, what happens to reflexes? So what happens to reflexes? Reflexes become hyperactive. Whenever the tone increases, the reflex activity also increases. Third one. In which kind, UMN versus LMN, is atrophy seen? Atrophy. As long as the reflex arc is intact, you will not find an atrophy. So which neuron forms a part of the reflex arc? For a muscle not to atrophy, the muscle, the nerve which is entering the muscle should be intact. And the nerve which is entering the muscle is the LM. So in which lesion we have an atrophy and fasciculations? The nerve which enters the muscle is the LMN nerve. So in LMN lesions, we have atrophy. In UMN, there is no muscle atrophy. So, but to differentiate UMN versus LM, these are three important points which you have to remember. This is Brown-Séquard syndrome, is hemisection of the spinal cord. Okay, this is the spinal cord. Okay, suppose there is injury on the right side. Hemisection of the spinal cord is known as the Brown-Séquard syndrome. So suppose there is injury on the right side. So this one all is injured. Okay, we are drawing the spinal cord, same like this one. Okay, so there is hemisection of the spinal cord, SC2 level. So what are the symptoms you are going to find? First question I'm going to ask you is, pain and temperature, are they lost on same side or the opposite side? I'm going to ask you only 3 or 4 more questions and that will be the end of this session. If you understand the Brown-Séquard syndrome, you have understood all the 3 pathways. Suppose there is a hemisection of the spinal cord at C2 level. So what happens to pain and temperature at C4 level? Pain and temperature, that is below the C2 level, pain and temperature is lost on the same side or opposite side? Where is the decussation of pain and temperature fibers? Dr. Abdul said same. Is everyone take the same as Abdul? Dr. Shivank also said same. Let me revise once again. Okay. I will draw the spinothalamic tract. So this is going descending on the same side. Where does it decussate? It decussates in the spinal cord. Am I clear? It decussates in the spinal cord. So if there is an injury at C2, at C4 on which side is it? Opposite side or same side? Dr. Ramanathan said opposite side. Dr. Shivank and Dr. Abdul, do you want to correct yourself? So at C2 level, there'll be loss of pain and temperature on the same side. But at C4 level, there is loss of pain and temperature on the opposite side. Am I clear here? If I'm not clear, I will take time and explain. So this red fiber tract, which I've shown, is the spinothalamic tract. Now I will change the color so that you will not have a. So blue color will be dorsal column tracts. So where does the dorsal column sit? The dorsal column sit in the medulla. So I'm showing here. So the fibers are coming from the opposite side, decussating above, going on the same side and crossing. So the loss of vibration, touch, pressure is on the same side or opposite side. So the loss of vibration, touch, pressure is it on the same side or opposite side? So the dorsal column symptoms will be on the same side. So loss of vibration will be on the lateral side. Loss of pain temperature will be on the opposite side. And weakness, third question is weakness. Weakness will be on the same side or opposite side? Pyramidal tracts. Pyramidal tracts are also similar to the dorsal column. They are decussate in the medulla. So weakness will be on the same side or opposite side? Same side. So what you have to remember is, so in the C2 segment, weakness, pain temperature, dorsal column, everything will be ipsilateral and on the same side. Whereas in the lower segments, everything will be on the same side. So what will be on the opposite side? Pain temperature will be on the contralateral side. So what you have to remember is, in Brown's equine syndrome, everything is on the same side, but only thing which is on opposite side is the spinothalamic tracts, which are involved on the opposite side. I think if you have understood this one, it's more than sufficient for this session. And from next session onwards, I will concentrate only on the clinical aspects. In next session, I didn't decide, but most probably I will teach you the CT scan of the brain. Majority of you are not exposed to CT scan of the brain, so try to attend the next session. And if you have, do you have any doubts in this session? Dr. Kishan was asking, superficial reflex is absent or present in human type. In the acute phase, it is absent, but in the chronic phase, it recovers. I think there are no other questions. If there are no other questions, can we end this session for today? So the next session, junction of injury at the junction of UM and LMN. No, they are too microscopic. Yeah, I don't know. That's a synapse. Junction at the synapse, I don't know. And even if there is a injury at the junction of UM and LMN, the clinical features will be similar to LMN only. And if there are no doubts, I will end my session here. Thank you. Thank you for today. Thank you everyone for attending this session. And from next sessions, it's all clinical things. So try to attend as much as possible. And I will try to catch only those clinical sessions which are more relevant for you. One thing which I've thought is more relevant for you is the CT scan of brain. I will take in 3 or 4 sessions so that by the end of these 3 or 4 sessions, you'll be confident enough in reading the CT scan of the brain. Thank you, everyone, and good night.